Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Following by Jacqueline Druga, narrated by Tina Wolstencroft. 1. The Light.
"That's your third eye," my Baba would say.
I was all of 10 years old when she first said that to me.
"You have a third eye, my little girl. A third eye."
With no idea of what that meant, I was certain she was making fun of a disability that I didn't know I had. Was it a mole? A scar? Where was this third eye that I couldn't see? Baba also had a way of doing what my mother called gin talking. Maybe she only saw that third eye when she was 3 gin and tonics in. The same as when she saw a blue magic marker on the news anchor's face during the evening news.
"Wipe it off," she'd say. "They have people who do that."
Baba was old world. She came over from Europe when she was a teenager, and while I understood her English, everyone else had a hard time. Except when she mentioned the third eye. I never remembered her talking about my supposed birth defect until I was 10. Maybe she thought I was old enough to handle the abuse. I broke down and told my mother that Baba was making fun of me, which was a hard decision for me to make. Telling my mother something bad about my father's mother just made her smile. Just another reason for my mother to hate her. But she explained the third eye thing to me. It wasn't the djinn talking. It was my grandmother's crazy beliefs. A third eye to people like my Baba was someone's ability to see or know things others do not or before they happened. "It's an evil thing to believe," my mother told me. "If you do, you'll be in purgatory for all eternity." I wasn't up on that purgatory stuff, but I was pretty sure purgatory was temporary. She explained to me that my great-grandmother was a gypsy fortune teller who actually inspired Stephen King's novel Thinner. They just left out that it was based on a true story. I wasn't sure how much of that was true. My mother and Baba had a constant battle. Both had their own versions of good versus evil. I loved them both. As I got older, their fights were amusing. After my mother explained the third eye thing to me, I told Baba about it and how I thought she was making fun of something on my face. She laughed so hard and said,
"No, child, you have the third eye, the ability."
She explained all those times I remembered conversations that hadn't happened yet, or news stories that had yet to occur. The voices telling me things. One time distinctively stood out to me. It was family dinner at Baba's. "It's a shame that spaceship blew up. Those poor people," I said. "So sad for their kids."
"Harper," my mother scolded.
"Why would you say such a thing?" 2 days later, it happened. All part of that third eye. It started making sense. No wonder she kept asking me to find out a good winning horse at the track. She wrote down in a blue journal all the things I said when I said them, then next to them, the dates it actually occurred. "Have I been doing this all my life?" I asked. "I don't remember."
"No," Baba told me. "Ever since you stepped into light, when you came back, you had the gift. And it will only get stronger."
Stepped into the light. She was right. I did. And I was told I should never have made it back. 2. Near death. I was 9 when it happened. With only a half-block walk to the bus stop, my mother allowed me to walk alone. She stood on the porch, though, every morning, even if it snowed. Coffee at hand, she would wait there and watch me until I got on that bus. That particular morning, it was chilly and foggy, typical early fall. I didn't want to wear a skirt. My knees were cold. But it was picture day, and my mother wanted me to look my best in the class photo. She woke me up early to make my hair perfect, pulled back on top and curled. With my little windbreaker on and a backpack far too big and heavy, I walked to the bus stop. I was the only one that caught the bus at that stop. Like always, I kept looking back at my mother.
She was there watching if anything would happen. I wanted to wave once more, and I turned. They say the big, bulky backpack saved my life. That was the last thing I remembered, and then everything went black. My mother often told the story how she watched in horror, and I never saw it coming, standing on that corner, my back to the road. Mr. Jenkins wasn't paying attention. He had spilt his coffee and was too focused on that when he made the turn, cutting it too close and hitting me in the process. I flew from her sight, she said, and then she took off for me, screaming for someone to call for help. I was dead. Dead for several minutes, and it was the bus driver who brought me back. I don't remember that. I do remember going from looking at my mother to black. Complete and utter black. That was only a second, and I was moving, fast and furiously, shooting through a black void that suddenly lit up with streaks of light all around me. The lights moved as I did, like I was in warp speed in a Star Trek episode. The intensity of their glow grew until I faced this brilliant and powerful light. It was so warm. I wasn't confused. I wasn't scared. I felt as if I was supposed to be there. Blurry shadows of figures were in the light waving at me. There were no angels or pearly gates. From the shadowy figures stepped my Uncle Earl, my mother's brother. Uncle Earl had died a year earlier. At that time, when it happened, I didn't know how he died, just that it was tragic, and he was young. 22, my mother would say. He's gone at 22. But we never really talked about him much. Uncle Earl always looked like a movie star to me, perfect hair and teeth. He waved and stepped to me.
Wait for it, Harper.
Wait for what? My voice was weird, echoing. Even his sounded as if it came from underwater.
You can't step any closer, he said. Just wait for it. And Harper, tell them I'm here. I'm here. I didn't do it. If I did, I wouldn't be here.
Huh?
Crack. Gasp.
I opened my eyes and was looking at my mother. She was crying and screamed out that I was alive. I don't know what that noise was that snapped me out of it or back from wherever I was. It was hard to breathe. I was gasping, trying to catch my breath. Every part of my body hurt. There was so much pain. I wanted to cry, but it hurt. Thankfully, I floated back to sleep, waking up in the hospital several days later with everyone around me, my mother, father, Baba, and Aunt Connie. The only recollection I had was waving to my mother and having that weird dream experience. After I came to my senses and had some water, I told her about what happened. I saw Uncle Earl in my dream, I told her. He said to tell you he was there, and he didn't do it. If he did it, he wouldn't be there. My mother gasped. Her face turned completely white, and she ran from the room.
I'll be back, Pumpkin,
my father said, chasing my mother. What did I say? I asked. Aunt Connie stepped to me.
You saw Earl? In your dream?
I guess. I was waving to Mommy, and after it was black, I was with Uncle Earl. Aunt Connie stepped back, hand to her mouth, and started to cry. Baba moved to my bed and held my hand.
You rest.
Baba, did I say something wrong?
No, child.
Baba shook her head with a gentle smile.
You said something everybody needed to hear.
3. Uncle Earl. How it started is how it ends. I don't know when I heard that for the first time, but it held true in my case. My entire fourth grade year was spent in hospitals and rehab. I had to learn to walk again. I broke my leg and my hip. both of which my mother claimed was the reason I wasn't tall. I tried to catch up on schoolwork, but it was useless. The near-death experience I had was the only strange thing that happened for a year. Then the third eye stuff began. It wasn't all the time. I had no way to control it. Once I realized what it was, I was forbidden by my mother to practice with Baba. Baba surprisingly adhered to those wishes, telling me, "I am here to talk to and answer questions." She kept writing things down when I would spew them out. I could tell she wanted to tame me, fine-tune these abilities she believed I got when I died. Then, around my 13th birthday, things made a switch. I stopped hearing voices, sputtering out events yet to come, and started having the strangest dreams. When they happened, they were vivid dreams that made sense, and in them, I was fully aware I was dreaming. People would come up and talk to me. I didn't know them. I was able to control when I woke up. If someone scared me, I snapped awake. The scary people didn't come often. They were nothing compared to when it happened when I wasn't in bed for the night. If I was tired and tried to focus, or focused too much on something, it sent me into a hypnotic state and the dream would start. Once, in eighth grade math, I was trying to focus on the teacher. Her monotone voice absorbed into my mind, and suddenly, it was just an echoing voice in the distance, and I was alone in the classroom. A man appeared. He looked like he was from some old movie. Hair slicked back, leather jacket. He tapped me on my shoulder.
"Hey, do you have a second?"
he asked. I screamed. I screamed so loud, I snapped awake. The teacher was at the board. She looked at me, and so did everyone in the class. In the embarrassing silence, I claimed I saw a mouse. I told Baba about it. I didn't know who these people were talking to me or why. It was driving me insane. I was grateful it wasn't happening every night, but when it happened, when I wasn't in bed, that scared me.
"No longer focus for too long," said Baba. "It's causing you to go into a meditative state, and in that state, you are lucid dreaming."
How do I do that when I'm trying to pay attention in class?
"Stop focusing on one object or one person. If you are listening to her instruction and focusing on that, shift your attention from the teacher to the paper to someone in class. You can listen, but your eyes and ears cannot focus for too long on the same thing."
Admittedly, I tried the opposite to see if she was right in what was causing it. I sat in my living room one day and focused on the science guy doing a television show, listening to his words, watching only him. Sure enough, it happened. My living room was transformed into some room from decades earlier. The television wasn't there. It was replaced with a radio. I sat on a thick green couch. An ashtray was on the wooden coffee table before me.
"Hello," the pleasant woman's voice said. "My, don't you look lovely?"
Slowly, I looked over my shoulder. A woman in an apron smiled at me. The entire left side of her face was burned. Instead of screaming, being scared, I simply said, "Wake up! Wake up!" I did. Science Guy was back on the television. My living room was normal. Baba was right, and from that moment on, I stuck to her advice, never letting it happen. Of course, Baba was the only one I spoke to about it. I didn't dare mention it to my mom. Until I didn't have a choice. It was the last time in my youth that it occurred. Actually, it was the last time anything third eye or ability related occurred. A normal night's sleep, I was tired, and after reading a little, I fell asleep, book on my chest. What the actual dream was, I don't recall. But it went from the dream state of ridiculous subconscious dumping to a room. a room I had never been in, and the second I was there, I realized I was dreaming. Then Uncle Earl appeared.
You have a light about you.
He waved his finger and smiled.
You are very hard to get near.
I don't know what you mean.
Your light shines for all to see, and we all know.
Know what? He shook his head.
Doesn't matter. I finally got to you. I need to get a message to your mom and Connie. My sisters need to know.
Know what? I asked. I can't talk about you. I'm not allowed. They cry. Uncle Earl lowered his head.
That's because they think I did it.
Did what?
Harper, they think I killed that little girl. They think I did terrible things to her. I didn't. I just found her when I was walking. I didn't know her. I didn't do it, I swear,
he said sincerely.
Those men who killed me thought I did those terrible things. I never got a chance to say I didn't.
Men killed you?
You didn't know?
I shook my head and started to cry.
Harper, listen to me. You have to get them to believe it, okay?
They won't listen because they won't talk about you.
Okay, then I'll talk to your mom.
How?
Take my hand.
He extended it to me. I took his hand and he squeezed it tight.
Everyone knows you can do this,
he said.
That's why they all try to talk to you.
I don't understand, I replied.
One day you will. Now, wake up, Harper.
Uncle Earl spoke softly.
Harper, wake up.
With a heavy breath, I opened my eyes and sat up. It was like I was holding all the air in my lungs and finally released it. The book on my chest fell to my lap, and when I reached for it, I saw Uncle Earl standing at the floor of my bed. He wasn't a solid form, almost a slightly glowing holograph projection, desaturated some to remove color from his form, but around his entire body was a halo of colorful lights. I gasped and scooted back.
Wake up, wake up, wake up!
Harper, you're awake. Go get your mother. I only have a few minutes before I have to go back into the light.
I didn't move.
Harper, go!
I flung off my covers, jumped out of bed, and raced to my door. Before I left, I looked back once more to see Uncle Earl, and then I bolted out. It was still early in the evening. My mother was probably downstairs watching some late-night talk show. I raced from my room, and as soon as I turned the corner for the stairs, I saw her walking up.
What's wrong?
She asked.
Uncle Earl is in my room.
Harper, stop.
Mom, no, he's there.
I hurried down a few stairs and grabbed her hand.
He's there. He wants to talk to you, and he doesn't have time.
I pulled her.
Please. Harper, you were having a bad dream. That's
Mom.
Fine.
She was reluctant. I was reluctant. I had just dragged my mother to my room. Was it all a hallucination? When we walked in, would he be gone? Sure enough, the moment my disbelieving mother walked into my room, she nearly crumbled. Her legs buckled and she grabbed my dresser for support.
Tina,
Uncle Earl said.
Tina, I didn't do it. I didn't do it. Please know that. It wasn't me.
He extended his arm.
Please know that.
My mother dropped to her knees on my floor. She let out this deep, hurt-filled wail, throwing her head back as she did. From the corner of my room, like a bright star, a light appeared.
I have to go,
Uncle Earl said.
Please, no, I didn't do it.
He stepped into that light, looking once over his shoulder at me.
Thank you,
he said. And when he stepped into that light, he vanished, and the light seemed to be sucked out of the room. My mother sobbed. She sobbed right then and there like I had never heard her. She stayed on the floor of my room for the longest time, crying, saying nothing. I thought we formed some sort of paranormal bond at that moment. Perhaps we did. I would never know what she thought or how she felt. She refused to mention that incident ever for the rest of our lives. That was also the last time, for the longest time, that I had a crazy dream experience or anything third eye related. Until that day, and the floodgates opened. 4. Funeral for a friend of a friend. I was convinced that the gift given to me when I died at a young age was gone. In fact, I was sure of it. My mother hated it, and at first thought when I had died that some sort of demon possessed me, enabling me to bring my Uncle Earl through from the bowels of hell. Her words, not mine. I had to have gone to hell because Uncle Earl committed an unspeakable act and was beaten to death over it. She took me to several priests and bishops, and when they realized I not only could be in a church, I could touch holy water. I wasn't possessed. I was more than likely suffering from a form of psychosis. After a few hospital stays in my teens, I was sent to a special school for girls at a convent in Virginia. Complete silence after 8 at night, medication before bed. The medication allowed me to pass into REM sleep without ever lucid dreaming. Another medication stopped me from doing that focused trance I locked into. Sometimes I was curious if I went off the medication, would the gift come back? I thought about it a lot over the years, until finally I thought I had my answer. I started a new job at a new restaurant, an upscale Italian eatery that offered benefits. There was a lapse in my health insurance because of the new job, and the medications were out. Other than putting on a few pounds, nothing happened. No sudden trances or lucid dreaming. So when my friend Keith asked me to meet him at Brenner Funeral Home for the viewing of his friend Rick, I said yes. It had been before the final Uncle Earl incident that I had been in a funeral home or a cemetery. I successfully avoided ever going to either. I'd make up an excuse. It was the flu, pink eye, or lice. Things people knew were highly contagious. If there was a service in a church, I would go. It was probably more a mental thing, believing I was protected in a church. Before the gift was lost, if I went near a cemetery or funeral home, I felt things, heard things, and was scared. That was done. 2 months off medication and nothing. Sure, I told Keith. I'll meet you there. I didn't want to spend my day off at a funeral home, but it was Keith asking. It made sense that Keith didn't want to go alone. He didn't want to face Rick's mother. Keith felt partly to blame because he was supposed to meet Rick the night Rick died. I told him that was ridiculous. Rick was an idiot. He still would have gotten drunk and, for the sake of a viral video, did a balance beam stunt on the railing of that bridge. Only difference was if Keith was there, Keith would have jumped in the river to save Rick, and I would have lost my best friend of 30 years. We had known each other since we were 7. Keith was the only friend that wrote me weekly letters when I was in the convent. The only friend that came to see me at the hospital, and even though he was Jewish, went to weekly confessions with me because my mother said I had to keep a clean soul. I wasn't sure when Rick came into the picture. Maybe during Keith's rockstar phase, but definitely before Keith wanted to become a social influencer. Neither one of them were having any success. To me, they were both too old to be social media influencers. The last I looked, Rick had 40 subscribers and Keith had 16, four of which were me, his mother, my mother, and Baba. At 94 years old, Baba loved Keith's videos. She laughed and watched them over and over. I didn't get it. The visitation time started at 1, and Keith and I planned to meet at 3. I arrived 3 minutes late, and the parking lot was packed. I didn't see Keith's little smart car. Then again, it wasn't unusual for his mother to drive him. He was the only grown man, pushing 40, that I knew had his mother drive him so he could do videos in the car. There were so many cars. I didn't think Rick had that many friends. Thinking he had a big family, I parked. To the right of the door, roped off, was a long line of people. Some cried. Some held their phones, taking selfies with a funeral home in the back. They were at a distance from the entrance, so I made my way to the front door. A man in a suit stood there. I assumed he was a greeter until he stopped me.
"Friend, family, or fan?"
he asked. "Fan? Rick has fans?"
"Mr. Kramer was a social influence star."
"Since when?" "Last I looked, he had 40 subscribers."
"Look again."
I pulled out my phone, searched him, and gasped. "How does someone get a million subscribers in a couple?"
"Create a viral video."
"Oh my God," I said. "Did the bridge thing go viral?"
"Yep. So, I'm going to take it your family or friend."
"I'm support. I'm meeting his friend Keith here." The man looked at the clipboard.
"Keith's last name?"
"Levy." He stepped aside.
"Please, go in. I'll warn you, though. Fan visitation starts at 4.
Considering the fact that I didn't see Keith and the greeter didn't mention that he was there, I sent him a text while my phone was out. After I hit send, I put the phone in my purse. I was about to embark on a test. A funeral home without medication. I felt nothing, heard nothing. It was a relief. Before going into the main room with the open casket, I stopped at the visitor sign-in book. I added my name, then decided to look to see if maybe Keith had come in earlier. I flipped through the pages. I saw his mother's name, Gladys Levy. I didn't see Keith's. Another man in a suit approached me and whispered,
"If you're looking for Beyonce's signature, it's on the third page."
"Beyonce was here?" I questioned and quickly flipped the page.
"Yes, she's a big fan. Very torn up. This was tragic."
"Yeah," I muttered, thinking, avoidably tragic. "It was. Wow. I saw her signature." "She was here." He nodded. But Keith was not. I thanked the man, took a prayer card, and made my way to the main room. Would I feel something? Hear something? There were a lot of people, tons of flowers. No, Keith. A woman stood near the open coffin, and I walked to Rick. My heart pounded in my chest. It was the first soulless dead person I had seen in a long time. I stood directly at the coffin, looking down to Rick. He wore a long-sleeved t-shirt instead of a suit. His hair was weird and combed down, unlike the product-induced crazy hair he wore. But otherwise, he looked good. I had to know. I touched his arm. Nothing. I didn't know if I should have felt elated or sad. Suddenly, I found myself hands on Rick's body, feeling everywhere I could.
"Were you close?"
the woman standing by the coffin asked. Yeah. I just don't believe this is him." She nodded.
"I feel that. I'm his mother, Debbie."
I heaved in a gasp. "Oh, I am so sorry for your loss." My phone bleeped. "Would you?" I held up a finger. "Excuse me?" I reached into my purse and pulled out my phone. A text reply from Keith.
"Not coming."
"Asshole."
"Excuse me?"
Rick's mother asked. "Not you, not Rick. Keith." I held up the phone. "He's not coming."
"Good. My son is dead because of him."
I didn't know how to respond to that. I lowered my hand down. "I'm sure Rick doesn't blame him." Just as my hand rested on Rick's arm, I heard a voice. It was a man's voice and not his mother's.
"You don't think?"
the male voice said. With a slight shriek, I lifted my hand.
"What's wrong?"
Debbie asked.
"Nothing. I have to go."
I put my phone away. I need to kill Keith.
5. Just try. Keith was exactly where I expected him to be. In his basement family room, sitting center of the couch, controller in hand, staring intently at the video game he played. When he wasn't in front of his computer or walking around wearing that headgear camera filming stuff, he was playing video games. I really should have known he wasn't motivated enough, not even by his friend's death, to get out of those baggy shorts and Jurassic Park t-shirt. The front door was unlocked and I had walked right in. I didn't see his mother on my way to the basement. She was probably somewhere getting him takeout. Skipping over the pleasantries of saying hello or a bright and chipper hey, I stepped down the basement stairs and made my arrival announcement with, "You owe me $227.33. Keith laughed. "For what?" "My medication. Doesn't your insurance cover that?" "I don't have insurance yet. It hasn't kicked in. When I get my check, I'll pay for it."
"When's that?" I asked.
"There's a 60-day lag."
Keith's fingers moved frantically in his game playing.
"Don't worry, I got you covered."
"2 months," I shouted. "I'll be insane. And what the hell?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.